Requesting connection. Established. Encrypted. We're live. The show you've been asking for. Advice, technology, and community. Linux first, all others second. This is Ask Noah.
Live from AltaSpeed Technologies, the Ask Noah show starts right now. This is the show where we came to do all the things on Linux they said couldn't be done and take your questions on how to do the same. My name is Noah. I am your host. Delighted to be here with you as another episode of the Ask Noah show kicks off this hour. 855-450-NOAH. It's 855-450-6624. Or send an email to live at AskNoahShow.com. Joining me is my co-host, Mr. Steve Ovens. Welcome in, sir.
Good evening from a drying out South Dakota. It's been wet here. Wet. Yeah, we got rain and snow and sleet and yuck. But now today we got a break.
Okay, so when that happens, does your nerd projecting go up because you're like, oh, we're stuck indoors?
Nah. Honestly, we're not usually stuck indoors.
You're just like, I was just going to cowboy up and head outdoors anyway.
Yeah, the dogs still need to go out.
Okay. Fair enough. The dogs got to pee and all the things too, huh?
Yep. Well, and they need the exercise. They don't care. Especially the husky doesn't care.
1-855-450-NOAH. It's 855-450-6624. Or send an email to live at asknoahshow.com. We're going to switch up the order tonight. Do things a little bit different. The XZ Utils is a ubiquitous utility in Linux. It provides lossless data compression on virtually all Unix operating systems, including Linux. The XZ Utils provides critical functions for compression, decompression, and data utilities of all kinds. XZ also supports the legacy and LZMA format, making the component even more crucial. So you have likely used the XZ utilities at some point if you've used the Linux operating system. When you right-click on that folder and you try to make things smaller and you use compression, you say compress to, and you get the little .xz, or in a number of different other things to include the kernel, you're using this particular vulnerability. And what ended up happening was we found out that there are people that are contributing to code that we don't really know who there were. And I guess that asks one of my first questions that I'd be interested in your thoughts on. What do we really know about the people that contribute to code? Do you know who they are when you pull something down off the internet, or do you go, well, I don't know, it just has the repo that has the thing that supposedly fixes my problem, so I'm going to go get that thing? Which is it? So I want to take you back to 2021. It starts with a user by the name of JIAT75, or Jantan, back in 2021. Now, he opened a PR for libarchive. Fast forward to 2022. They submit a patch via a mailing list, and now we see a new persona that comes on to the scene, and that's Jigar Kumar, J-I-G-A-R Kumar. They begin pressuring for this patch to be merged. Soon after that, this Jigar Kumar begins pressuring Lossy:Colon to add another maintainer to the XZ repository. Now, 3 days after those emails pressuring Lossy:Colon to add another maintainer to the repository, our friend JIAT75 makes their first commit to XZ. So what you watch over the next few years is this slow progression of getting more and more trusted and gaining more and more control over the ability to commit code. Now, one of the things that I would tell you, we say this all the time, open source means more eyes on the code. More eyes on the code means more security. So undoubtedly, there's somebody listening that's thinking to themselves, but Noah, how could they have gotten that code up there without anybody noticing? Look at how insecure Linux is. So I would submit to you that if you look at what happened in the closest secondary attack, and this really pales by comparison, but I would say the second closest attack is something like the SolarWinds attack. That was a supply chain attack. That had proprietary code top to bottom, and somebody was still able to slip something in. The difference here is from that moment in 2022 on, everybody had the ability to follow along with what was happening. Fast forward to We're in 2022. Since that commit, they become a regular contributor to XE. They're currently the second most active, and it's kind of unclear exactly when they became trusted in the repository. Our friend Jagger Kumar, never seen from again. Now, another account, Dennis ENS, it also participates in this pressure with a similar name slash number formatted email, meaning or leading us to believe that it's probably the same person behind the keyboard. That account is also never seen outside of the discussion from XE. So something comes up and we want to put pressure to say, hey, yeah, we should take this action, should not take this action. That person shows up. Other than that, they're not to be heard from. So fast forward to last year, 2023. Our friend JIAT75 merges their first commit on January 7th, 2021, which gives us a good indication of when they started to gain trust, when people started to say, that person is just a person that contributes to code. In March, the primary contact, the email address associated in Google's OSS Fuzz is updated to be our friend Gia's email instead of Lossy Colon. So this is the point where it kind of fully shifts into Gia's corner. This year, 2024, a pull request from Google's OSS Fuzz is opened and changes for the URL project moves from one URL to another URL. Same base domain, but specifically set up for XE and for XE utils. Now, that domain, that parent domain, is hosted out of Finland, and we know what hosting provider that parent domain is pointed to. That XE subdomain instead points to GitHub pages, and that furthers the amount of control that Gia has over the product, because now all they have to do is push to that GitHub page. And anybody looking or watching that parent domain or that XE subdomain is being directed back to that GitHub page. Now enters a Microsoft engineer. And this is where the rubber meets the road. Because again, for years, Microsoft has been saying, we love open source. Open source makes us a ton of money. Of course we love open source. We want to participate in open source. And I think in the back of our heads, and I absolutely include myself in this, we always kind of second guess them. Yeah, do they really? Do they really care about open source? Or is it just more along the lines of, well, here's the deal. This week, it paid for itself in spades because Microsoft is contributing to the paycheck of a person who is paid to be working on Microsoft's Postgres offerings. That person, an open source developer by the name of Andres, I hope I'm pronouncing this right, Furend, discovers that he has some performance issues on his Debian system with SSH. Now, specifically, SSH logins were consuming too many CPU cycles and were generating errors with Valgrind, a utility that he used to monitor his computer's memory. So he digs into it and he eventually discovers that the problems are the results with the updates that had made to the XE utils. So he starts digging into it further. And eventually he figures out, oh my gosh, this has been backdoored. One of the largest utilities in Linux, things that are available on many Linux distributions, technology that's used to compress all sorts of things, it's been backdoored. So that Friday, he publishes on the open source security list a disclosure of the updates that were the result of somebody intentionally planting a backdoor in the compression software. Quote, Thomas Rossia, a researcher at Microsoft, published a graphic on Mastodon that helps visualize the sprawling extent of the nearly successful endeavor to spread a backdoor with a reach that would have dwarfed SolarWinds event from 2020. The backdoor manipulated SSHD, the executable file used to remote SSH connections. Anyone in possession of the predetermined encryption key could stash any code of their choice in the SSH login certificate, upload it, execute it on the backdoor device. No one actually had seen the code uploaded, so it's not known what the code attacker planned to run. In theory, the code could also allow for just about anything to include in stealing encryption keys or installing malware. Now, Steve, one of the things that you brought up when we were kind of talking about this before the show, this really is limited to a certain subset of people. You have to have a pretty specific set of circumstances. You have to be using SSH with systemd, and that's not terribly common.
Yeah, so ultimately, what's happening here is that the XZ library is not built into SSH. SSH has the ability to use the XZ library for additional types of compression, but out of the box, it's not being used. What has to happen is The Fedora and Debian maintainers patch the OpenSSH service, pardon me, in order to hook in with the systemd notification. And as part of that, the libxe stuff ends up getting pulled in. So if you are on a distribution like Arch, for example, that doesn't patch OpenSSH, this doesn't really affect you. On top of that, you had to be on a leading edge distribution like Debian Unstable or the version of Fedora that was released just a couple of days before this vulnerability was kind of announced. So at least in terms of real life, impact, it is relatively low because of how quickly it did end up getting caught. So I suppose we're lucky on that regard.
When you think about what you're looking for on the internet, when you go out to the internet and you're going to get a piece of code or a piece of software that you're going to run on your computer, how much, if any, scrutiny do you put on, who's the Yahoo on the other side of this repo that put this code up on the internet for me to have?
I guess it depends on what my intention is behind the code. So, for example, I might go get something. You and I will talk about this a little bit later, but there's something called Angry IP Scanner, which is a bit of Java code that has been around for a very long time. Because it's been around so long, I kind of have an inherent more trust in that software being okay, and I might actually go and get the latest release out of the Git repo. Largely, I stick to what's in my software repository. Having said that, I do use the AUR, and I don't put a ton of scrutiny into that. I will look at the package builds, but I don't usually look forward to beyond the fact that it pulls down a binary or a block like a tarball and has an MD sum, like an MD5 or an SHA sum. So I don't put a ton of scrutiny beyond that. It's been sufficient to know that the people who are making the package builds are already building in the accountability of, like, here's how you know if you should be getting the right tarball or not.
So a family member, a friend, somebody comes to you and says, Steve, I'm new to computers. I know nothing about this stuff. What do you tell them when they say, how do I know how to keep myself safe, or how do I know how to not execute malicious code on the internet?
Well, generally speaking, if they're new to computers and stuff like that, they probably don't have a highly sophisticated need for software that goes beyond like a web browser and the standard stuff that you find in the average package repository. Like, we're talking the average package repository having somewhere between 30 and 50,000 packages. The new user doesn't need to do anything more than just use what's in the software store that comes with their distribution.
Well, I can see that to get started, but then I feel like we get into something like, I want to add Spotify, or I want to install Google Chrome, or I want to something that didn't come with my distro's repository, and then I feel like that's where it starts to go sideways.
I mean, it definitely can be a challenge. What do you end up doing?
I really struggle with this. I'll be honest with you. This is one of the first things, and I was really happy, as weird as that sounds, for this to come to light, because it caused me to start asking the question, what do we really know about the people that contribute to code? Now, my answer to that is, you know what, Steve? I don't have to know who this guy is or what he contributes to code. Do you know why? Because my friend, who I've never met and have never heard his name, wouldn't have known him from Joe from 5 minutes ago, from Microsoft, also looked at that, and he is way more knowledgeable and experienced in the nuances of the XE repository to be able to look through and say, something doesn't look right here. So I may not know, but I am more comfortable using a piece of software that exists on the internet with a bunch of other people who do know, paying attention to it. And I feel like, are there examples like Heartbleed where you have things that are very, very prominent, lots of eyes on it? We all look back and go, well, gee, somebody should have caught that. Yeah, 100% that happens. At the same time, I also watch proprietary, very large, very expensive companies get rolled as well. So in the end, if I can achieve a similar or slightly better than security with open source, I feel like that's the better route. And oh, by the way, at least all of that dialogue is out in the open. at least now, there, every time something like this happens, I feel like we kind of double down. And good things come out of that too, right? After Heartbleed, a whole bunch of organizations stepped up to start supporting some of these organizations that provide these critical technologies. That doesn't necessarily happen in the corporate world. In the corporate world, it turns into a, well, we got to shove this aside. Nobody better need to find out about it. Limit liability, limit how much people know, limit our damages, control the narrative. And it, I don't know, it just kind of gets out there. So I look at this and I say this is kind of a win, even though it's 2 years of potentially a security problem. Absolutely. And I do think there maybe is more that needs to be done in the way of we should pay attention to who we're pulling code in for. But largely what I tell people and what the practice I try to adhere to myself, if somebody's out there and they're putting code out on the internet, I try to pay some attention to what other person is that, what other things is that person doing? So before the show, we were talking about a gaming distribution by the dude, Glorious Agro, right? He's most well known for the Linux compatibility Proton stuff that works, for lack of a better way to put that. And so he takes Proton and has a variant that has all, you know, other little tweaks provided. So far as I understand it, that is what's used in things like the Steam Deck. And so he has produced an entire distribution based around gaming. Now, do we trust that? Well, we probably should, because we trust him to push code out to Valve.
Yeah, I mean, like there is one of those situations where when you've got popular software, somebody's going to have eyes on it. Like if you're talking specifically about the Proton stuff, someone has eyes on that. I guarantee, even if it's just simply nerd credit of like, haha, I found a bug, look at that.
Mm-hmm.
Or I helped contribute to this thing. I did a pull request. Like those sort of, I suppose, a lack of better way of putting it, bragging rights are important a lot in our community, as much geek as cred we matters. May or may not like that, right?
No, so. I think it's great. I think geek cred is a fantastic thing. It rewards people on the merits of their work in the geek world.
Yep. And so because of that, anything that is remotely popular is going to get eyes on it, because people either genuinely want to help or they want to be associated with the project or whatever. And so the challenge is, how do you get the software to the popularity where it is going to have that kind of geek cred draw to it? Like, and that's the challenge.
Here's the other thing I think it brings to light. I hear this all the time. I may have even participated in this a bit. Well, it's Linux, it's immune from viruses, it doesn't get any... Well, actually, as it turns out, if it's capable of executing code, somebody can write malicious code. That's kind of how that works, right? If my system is going to obey the instruction set that I give it, who's to say I can't write a malicious instruction set or an instruction set that does something that the user does not wish the computer to do? So it's kind of a misnomer and kind of a silly one if we think about it, this idea that Linux is immune for anything. It's simply not targeted by many of these things. And sure, it isn't often the most lowest hanging fruit, because yes, we do have, you know, privilege escalation and those sorts of things, and sandboxing and SE Linux and cgroups and names. All the things that we have, a bunch of security models and security things that we can use to try to lock the system down and make it more secure. So we're not hanging fruit all over the place. But at the same time, if it can execute code, it can be modified to execute malicious code. This is a perfect example of that. So I think there's a cautionary tale in pay attention to who's on the internet and the code that they're writing. Pay attention to the fact that just because you're running a Linux system, you can walk with your nose up, but you're subject to the rest of us of having malicious code executed on your box. But then I think we rest in this idea that if it weren't for open source and the nature of open source, Microsoft wouldn't have funneled hundreds of thousands of dollars to fund the paycheck of a developer who would eventually catch this major bug, because Microsoft is working on an open source project, that is to say Postgres, and they're offering around it. This guy is contributing to open source. They're using, or at least he is using, a function of open source in the way of SSH that leads him to this bug. So all of that happens because we're playing in the same sandbox with the same sand, and the corporate guys are doing their thing and they've got different goals maybe, but we all the ships in the ocean rise when the tide goes up. And so I think that's a huge, 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 huge win. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think that that is a point that often gets missed, is that, you know, when we're all playing in the same sandbox, as you said, you end up having people. So there's been a lot of speculation like, oh, well, it was a really lucky find, and you know, this guy was really working on a niche edge case and like how lucky was it and all that sort of stuff. And like, I suppose in some sense it is absolutely lucky, but in the other sense it's like, if you have enough people playing on the same common base, someone out there is going to be doing this sort of stuff. Like this guy was a performance tester, right? And he was doing performance testing, was like, something didn't add up. And I was trying to get ahead of it by using Debian Unstable and all the rest of that. And, you know, when you get, it's the same thing of having that nerd cred for the Proton stuff. It's like when you build enough critical mass behind something, you are going to have those people, those really, really smart, observant people that will find that, those edge cases for you.
Yeah. So thank you, Microsoft, for funding open source. Thanks for finding a critical security vulnerability. Thank you to the open source community that has eyes on the stuff that we all don't understand. But I am parking this every once in a while. There's a story or there's an event that comes out, and I think it really highlights some stuff very, very well. And this is going into this, absolutely going into that collection. For the next time that I have the conversation with somebody who goes, well, why do you care about open source audibility? You're not going to go read through the code. Yeah, you're right. I'm not. I wouldn't understand it if I did. But guess what? Somebody did. And because of that, we have an answer.
From the Linux Newswire newsroom, this is the Week in Review with JT.
For the week of March 31st, 2024, here's the Linux and open source news. The Jellyfin project has requested help testing their 10.9 release. Blender 4.1 is out. The new GNU Core Utils 9.5 release can yield 10 to 20% throughput boost for CP, MV, and CAT commands. Samba 4.20 is out. Tails 6.1 has been released. Linux Mint has announced that for version 22, it is adopting Pipewire and a new Linux kernel cadence. In security news, while investigating a Postgres performance issue, a Postgres developer recently discovered a backdoor in SSH caused by the upstream xzutils package. DinoDustRat, also known as XDealer, is a sophisticated C++ backdoor targeting multiple operating systems. A previous unknown Linux variant has been discovered. In hardware news, Merlin Shaw has released a fully open-source drop-in replacement for the 72-pin cartridge slot on a front-loader NES. And in AI news, Databricks has announced the launch of DBRX, a powerful new open-source large language model that it claims sets a new bar for open source models by outperforming established options like GPT 3.5 on industry benchmarks.
Every once in a while, we have to stop and look around and say, here are the tools that I rely on a daily basis. Here are the things that make my life possible. And in a week where everybody and the brother wants to get a jab in as to the failure of open source, Steve and I thought we'd take a moment to say thank you to some open source things. So Steve, I want to start here. What do you, if you started with, you made an interesting comment to me. You said, even if you're not using Arch Linux, the Arch Wiki can be tremendously helpful. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah. So, I mean, we're not the first people to kind of have observed this, but one of the things that's really interesting is that everybody who uses Linux in some fashion will likely have gone to the Arch Linux wiki without having run Arch. And I know that within Red Hat, we have referenced solutions and things like that that have been well articulated in the Arch wiki. And one of the things that's really useful is that if you have a little bit of knowledge, you can extract the Arch bits and just simply focus on how do I configure whatever it is? Like, how do I configure Xorg, or how do I configure ALSA? Because generally speaking, some weird esoteric configurations notwithstanding, it's going to be the same in terms of like, how does, you know, I don't know, how does my systemd units, how do they work on Arch versus Red Hat versus some other thing? And generally speaking, they're going to be exactly the same. And so the number of contributors to the Arch wiki is phenomenal. And the fact that they keep it up to date and it is as accurate as it is one of those things that just continues to astound me.
So you're sitting at home, and like anybody who likes podcasts, we also kind of like audiobooks because it's kind of like a podcast on steroids, right? And so you start introducing audiobooks to your family and making some suggestions, but it doesn't really take off. Then you found an open source project that caused it to take off. What was it?
Well, I'm sure that audio bookshelf is no secret to a lot of people in our audience, but it was one of those things where I hadn't really investigated. I have a really big Audible subscription. I've had an Audible subscription for a long time. And there are various ways to download the audiobooks that you own off of Audible. And I have done that, but it never really got any traction with my family. Have books they might listen to. I couldn't get anybody to listen to anything. And then I finally got down to setting up audio bookshelf, and it took off like wildfire. Like, my wife has listened to 17 books in the month and a half. My youngest son, who's 8, he just goes nuts over it. Like, it's his favorite activity now. Beyond, like, he doesn't ask to watch things now. He asks to go turn on his audiobook. And it's just, it was an amazing thing to watch, because I think it's of all the things that you can do, you're engaging your brain when you're listening to audiobooks, because you're using your imagination. You know, it's basically like reading without having the eye strain of reading, and possibly slightly more entertaining, because I don't know about you, but sometimes my inner monologue doesn't give characters any kind of particular voicing, but the voice actors that are doing it professionally can do a really phenomenal job at that.
You know, the other thing is multitasking, right? It's, for me, the impediment to reading is not, it's not that I'm illiterate, it's not that I'm incapable of reading, but the problem is I am often doing something else that doesn't permit me to just stare at a book. And the thing that I think is so beneficial about the nature of both podcasts and audiobooks is that it can be passive. So you can be working in the yard or working on a project or coding or typing something up or driving somewhere. And in the background, you've got that thing going on that causes your mind to kind of fade away. And all of a sudden, a 5 or 6 hour road trip turns into 20 minutes, or what feels like 20 minutes, because you're just flying through. And meanwhile, you're absorbing that knowledge. And so I'll go back and listen to books 3, 4, 5 times sometimes. Can you talk a little bit about audio bookshelf from the standpoint of, if I haven't heard of it, but the concept of self-hosting audiobooks appeals to me. How do I get the audiobooks? How do I set it up? How do I connect to it if I'm not sitting in my home?
So I guess the point of audio bookshelf is, just like Jellyfin, you have to acquire your media legally somewhere else. And there are a lot of places you can go out and buy, like, DRM-free books. I've been on the Audible sauce for a very, very long time. And so I've got several hundred books in Audible. And honestly, it works for me. I don't have any particular qualms with their DRM, just because there are all kinds of legal ways to do your own backups there. So once you have your media, essentially you audio bookshelf can be run as a container. I run it just out of the Arch repository. They've got a package for it, and I put Apache in front of it. And in terms of accessing it, it's the same thing as any other application, in terms of, if you need to access it from outside of the house, you need to be able to have, you're either exposing it to the internet, which, if you're going to do that, definitely put some sort of proxy and or authentication in front of it. Even Apache basic auth is probably a good idea. They do have, like, username and password for audio bookshelf, and you can enable SSL and all the rest of that. But for me, if I was exposing it to the internet, I probably am going to rely on authentication that's been around for a long time, as opposed to something that's secondary to the project. And I don't want to speak for them necessarily, but, you know, they're trying to make a really good audiobook player. They're not trying to make the most secure single sign-on sort of thing.
Somebody is going to roll their eyes at the next one here. But you and I were going through the things that we're most thankful of, and, like, what is it that we have to get bootstrapped on our machines? And both of us instantly go, Firefox. I don't know where we'd be without Firefox. And it's not just Firefox in the way of, hey, it's the browser that is not evil and doesn't try to suck up all your data and all the rest of it. It's also really beneficial in the way of Firefox ESR, providing ability to get into antiquated systems that otherwise wouldn't be supported. And Mozilla still says, hey, there was once a standard out here that people were using, and we're going to continue to support that frameworks of web until we can't support it anymore. And so they give options to a number of people. And so the Mozilla Corporation does a wonderful job with both Firefox, Thunderbird, their entire lineup of suites. It is my my default go-to browser. In fact, I'm kind of obnoxious about it insofar as if somebody hires me as a system administrator and asks me to set up a machine, even, you know, one of the questions I'll ask them is, what browser do you like? And typically the answer is Chrome or Edge, which is funny to me since they're both Chromium-based browsers. So it's really just, do you want Chrome or do you want Chrome with Microsoft's branding? But I'm obnoxious and I install Firefox anyway. And I tell people when they use it, I'm like, hey, if you want something that isn't grabbing all your data, check this one out. And so I don't know how effective it necessarily is or isn't in the end. My only other add-on to that is I was reading one of Kevin Mitnick's latest books, and he makes the recommendation not to store web history, to set your browser up so that every time you close it, it starts with a new session. And so I've been doing that for the better part of a year and a half now, just to kind of see how practical that is. Does my bank eventually get upset if I'm from a new computer every time I log in? Turns out the answer to that is no. And to the places that do complain about it, check out Nativefire, which will allow you to wrap your programs in like a little Chromium-based single thing so that if there's something that complains about wanting to be able to store obnoxious cookies, at least they're all stored in their own separate little container of sorts. But Firefox does it for both of us. Now, I think, Steve, you said last week you used Vivaldi for your work browser. So Firefox is what then for you? The personal place, the everything else thing?
It is my everything browser except for work. So, yeah, I love Firefox. When people complained about it being slow, I didn't really notice that. But I also have an irrational aversion to Google and have for quite a very long time. So maybe I just didn't know what I was missing.
You know, one of the things I think people don't talk about enough is even if you install the Chromium or the Chromium style browser, Vivaldi probably fits into here. There, it's a fork of Chrome. It's not Chrome proper. So we think we're getting a little bit away from Google, and maybe we are. My understanding is all those Chromium-based browsers, to include Nativefire, use Google fonts. And so Google is still keeping track at a very basic level of, hey, this IP connected in and is using a Chromium-based browser.
Yep. I mean, that's my understanding as well. So there are times where I have client stuff that just legitimately doesn't work in Firefox for some reason or another. Mm. That, you know, if it was personal, I probably would take the time to try and track down how to make it work in Firefox. But with it, when it's a work thing, it's like I can't detour and like spend an hour trying to figure out what's going on in the browser to make it work properly. I just need it to go right now. So
yeah, 100%.
You know, there is a practicality issue there.
Sure. I mean, yeah. I mean, if the boss isn't paying for that, the boss is paying to get the thing done, then we just have to get the thing done. 2Bit in the chat room says, I use Brave, built-in Tor browsing. I will tell you this, Steve. I said this to my wife the other night. I believe in 10 to 15 years, if we have even that long, I believe that we're going to reach a point where the regular internet is just, it's not that it's not going to cease to exist or anything like that, but it just isn't going to be the place where all the cool kids hang out, right? As I'm watching what's happening with Truth Social, and as I'm watching what's happening with Twitter now X, and as I'm watching as people jump from one platform to the next, they all suffer from the same problem. That is to say, if something is unpopular enough, it gets turned off, or you get turned off or censored or told that you can't say that thing. And so where are all those people going to wind up? And I think all those people are going to wind up on open source, decentralized platforms and or things like Tor. I hate the concept of the dark web. That always kind of rubbed me the wrong way. No, it's just the internet for people that don't want to, I don't know, what, play by the rules? That want, I don't know. What the internet used to be, where you could just be an anonymous person that could show up and you could do a thing, and then if you made a mistake or said something stupid or asked a dumb question, you could just delete that account and start over with a new account, and no one was the wiser and things were great. And in today's day and age, you want to go sign up for something. Well, we need your phone number. Why? Well, we need to know who you are. We need to know where you live. We need to know where to come after you if there's a legal thing, or if we want to, I don't know. I don't like it. It just doesn't have a good feeling. It doesn't leave a good taste in my mouth, Steve. I don't know how else to put it.
Yeah, I'm not interested.
Whisper. This is something I hadn't heard of until tonight. Tell me about Whisper.
So it's not Whisper, it's Whisper.
Whisper.
And the reason why there's a distinguishment
here is because... Put some bubblegum in your mouth and then say it.
Whisper. So OpenAI does a project called Whisper. And so this is Whisper. And it's a combination of a bunch of projects together that gives you a nice UI where you can feed in audio or a URL or video, and it will generate transcripts or various types of subtitles. There we go. Words are hard. It supports
That's why you need the subtitles.
Yeah, exactly. It supports all kinds of different languages, and I use this at work as a very handy thing. So instead of taking notes, if I get permission from my clients to make an audio recording of the meeting, I can then just throw this through and get the actual transcript of what happened. And that can be invaluable. Not only that, it's useful for, I've used this for language learning. So I record my language learning sessions with my teachers, and then I throw it through this, and then I toss that into some AI somewhere and just say, hey, you know, kind of summarize, where did I have problems in this lesson, right? And that's useful too as a tracking over time. And that's only really possible by having the transcripts available. And accurate transcripts used to cost a lot of money, like hundreds of dollars. And so this sort of thing is kind of a game changer for anyone who wants to learn languages or has any need whatsoever to extract text out of audio.
My dad, I was just thinking about this. I went back and looked in a conversation I was having with my dad, and he had asked me, he said, hey, do you know of anything that can take a YouTube video and generate a transcript from it? And at the time I was like, yeah, I'm not sure. I'm sure Google has something. I'm sure there's some functionality built into Google or YouTube, but I couldn't tell you what it is.
This one you can. Yeah. Yep, you can feed the YouTube URL right into it.
Very cool. So some honorable mentions, and I guess Whisper was in that category, but KVM. So the ability, I remember sitting at I believe it was a presentation at LinuxCon. It would have been 2013, 2012, somewhere in there, maybe 2014, somewhere in that era. And I remember watching a guy do a demonstration in which he installed Red Hat on a bare metal box, and then installed Red Hat on a bare metal box, and installed KVM, and then installed Red Hat on a VM. Then he ran a series of hardware tests against the first box that just had Red Hat installed on the bare metal box. Then he ran those same performance tests against the VM that was virtualized on the bare metal box through KVM. And it was near identical performance. And I thought, man, this is incredible. You and I both use KVM. Well, heck, your half of your job is really underneath the hood, I suppose, supported by KVM.
Yeah, this is a project that I'm so thankful for. I look at the other virtualization platforms out there, and they're a lot heavier weight, and they have reason to, right? There's a lot of whiz bang and end user friendliness that goes along with that. But for what I need this thing to be fast, spin up the VM and just get down, like get out of my way. And I can't even describe how much I rely on KVM. The vast majority, even stuff that run in containers, gets stuck in a KVM first. And I might have multiple containers inside there, but I just have this weird tick where I don't run my containers on the bare metal anyways. So yeah, my entire infrastructure, including Home Assistant, would not be running without KVM.
So this is a true story, battle story from just yesterday, the day before. So we get this client, a call from a client, hey, server's running slow, can you take a look at it? Well, it's a Windows server, but it's not on the bare metal, it's in a KVM box. So okay, this is good. So we log in. To your point about it being less whiz-bangy than other solutions, are there times where you have to have, where you go through the process of setting up a server where you want two hosts and you want to fail over and do all those things? Yes, 100%. But in the end, KVM will allow you to do all of those things. But in this particular case, it was a single host. It was a single VM running on said single host. And the problem that we had was I was remoted into the VM, didn't have VPN access, anything like that. So he screen share in to the VM itself. Well, the problem there is I can pull Cockpit up on the host, but any changes I want to make to the VM obviously require me to power off the VM, which is my remote connection in. To add complication and frustration to the matter, the VM is obviously a Windows VM, so I can't have Vert Manager, which is my preferred way of interacting with these things. And so I kind of stopped for a second. I'm like, you know what? We don't actually need to do any of this. We can just drop to the command line and use Versh to spin up a brand new VM pointed towards an ISO of Kubuntu. And in a few minutes, a Kubuntu VM appeared on that same vhost. And it's so lightweight and so lean that even though it was suffering from performance problems, we later figured out because the disk was filled up to 100%, even though there were performance problems, we're able to get in, we're able to get the work done, we're able to clean up the mess, and then we're able to return it back into production, all remotely, all without ever setting a foot inside the building, and in large part because KVM is super flexible. And what I have come to appreciate over the past few years, when I got started with KVM, it was all Red Hat stuff. And as I've started to dip my toe into the Ubuntu side of things, primarily because of native ZFS support, it's been really nice that I can leverage the open source power of, well, this thing was created over here and designed to work over there, but the reality is I can move it over here and use the exact same tool in the exact same way that I want to use it, just with these added benefits of on this thing over there. And so, yeah, I would share your enthusiasm that KVM is great. And the other thing is, too, is in your model of, well, I don't want to run the containers on the bare metal, I want to run them in a VM. Reproducibility and all of that is great, and I'm all on board. I was explaining before the show, I'm going through this exercise where I intentionally blow my computers away every so often just to prove that I can reproduce them on a dime without any problems and really without any setback. At the same time, there is something magical and wonderful about, hey, I need to move that computer over to a new host. And I did this for a client a few weeks ago, and we just pick up all the QCOW2 files and move them off the drive and slide the new vhost in and slide all the QCOW2 files back and turn them all back on. And Bob's your uncle. It's like nothing ever changed. And I don't know, it's like magic. You can move, you can slide things around like they're hockey pucks.
It is magic. That's all there is to it.
Okay, so the nerds, the hardcore nerds are going to say, Nmap all the way, Nmap all the way. You have another IP scanner that you really like.
I use Angry IP Scanner a lot. I was mentioning this to Noah, and Noah's like, oh, does it run on Linux? And I was like, I don't know how to respond to this question. I didn't understand what was happening. So apparently Noah was saying that his experience was primarily on Windows running this.
That's right, yeah. And when I switched to Linux, it was funny. My this is a true story. My motivation for switching to Nmap was that's what was used in the Matrix. And so I figured if it was good enough for Neo, it's good enough for me. And I was going to learn it. Nmap is how the hackers work, yo.
I mean, Nmap does its job, and it does its job well. In this case, I tend to use it for, is the host up? Like,
yeah.
It returns in a nice GUI way, like IP, host name, ports that are open, and you can customize all of those sorts of things. And it is just genuinely really useful to figure out what's around you.
It's a really good networking tool particularly if you're getting into the industry, but even if you're a seasoned admin, just the ability to go look and say, what's on this network around? The amount of times, I would say, I'll bet it's half the time. I'm going to say about 50% of the time. Walk into a new client. Hey, good to meet you. I'm the new network guy. Okay, great. Awesome. How do you do this? What IP addresses are in use?
Warrow.
Who has a list?
Warrow.
Well, how do you pick one?
Well, I don't know.
Okay, great. Awesome. Starting from scratch. So, and the ability to fire a tool up and say, okay, here's what the lay of the land looks like right now. It's great. Flameshot.
Flameshot is a screenshot utility that, I don't know, I heard about it several years ago, and both my wife and I just really took to it. It's not like it's the king of all of the screenshot utilities, but it does a really good job of doing things like select an area. Like, I mean, it has everything that you might think. You can draw arrows very well. You can add text, do underlines, all kinds of fun stuff. What I like about it is you can save the screenshot to the clipboard. You can save it to a regular file, or you can have it open in the app of your choice. So if you're doing it and you need to adjust it, you can open it in, say, GIMP or something like that. And you can even upload it to various services. And so I find this tool very useful. I use it all the time when I'm doing documentation, all the time. It is my screenshot tool of choice.
So here's what was going to happen. We were going to fight. You didn't know that, but we were going to fight because I'm a huge Spectacle fan. However, I installed your silly Flameshot screen cap, and here's what I noticed right off the bat. It runs in the bar, and that's real nice because then it's not this huge application taking up the screen real estate that I want to be taking up by the thing I'm trying to screen cap. And the other thing I really like about it, when you it by default, it goes into rectangle mode or whatever selection to. I don't know what the proper name is, but the thing where I get to draw the part of the screen that I want to capture rather than capturing the entire screen. I don't know who or where somebody decided that the default should be the entire screen, but very rarely, if ever, do I want somebody else that I'm sending a screenshot to see everything that's on my screen. Typically, there's something specific I want to draw their attention to. And Flameshot, I think, allows you to do that super well. Add to that the annotation features. I think that's great. My only criticism was there's a lot of buttons that's around the thing where you screen get, and until you figure out what each one of those buttons does, can be a little intimidating.
It can be. Like I said, it's got a lot of good features. And the other thing that I do that I'm sure that you can do with others is you can keybind it. So like I have Control Shift Alt P, and that automatically brings up the Flameshot screenshot part of it just directly into it. So I find that really, really useful when I'm doing all kinds of stuff. But like I said, I've been using it a long time, so I didn't even think about, hey, there's a lot of buttons to this just because I've been using it for so long.
I'm probably pronouncing this wrong, but Anixi?
Yeah, so this is a utility that allows you to get a system readout. So this was put in by our producer JT, but I also second this one. I use this one a lot. It goes on almost all of my boxes, and it gives you a human readable output of your various system components. So there's been various takes on this from all kinds of other tools. I don't know. I just like this particular one, right? So I don't know what to say.
The other one that was added by Q5Sys, and this one you might not be as gung-ho about, BTOP.
Yeah, I mean, it's just another top, like it's a top utility on steroids. There's tons of them. I've used Glances. I like NVTOP. There's tons of them out there, but honestly, I don't have a super huge use for a giant graphical top utility. Mm-hmm. Right. Generally speaking, that's not where I'm going to look at things. But I understand where it's useful when you don't want to do something like Prometheus and you're trying to access a remote box. I get it. It's just not for me.
We'll have links for all of these in the show notes at podcast.asknoahshow.com. Last week, or maybe the week before, Pine64 released their most recent blog update that kind of let everybody know where they're at. And they've been busy over there. Now, here's the thing. I love Pine64. I don't have enough good things to say about these people. I would describe them like an adult toy store. If you go into the expectation that you're buying, you know, the competitor to the Apple Watch or the competitor to the Samsung phone or the competitor to the, you know, the ThinkPad or the MacBook or whatever, I think you're setting yourself up for disappointment there. However, if you set your expectations at, I want to compete against the Chromebook, or I want to compete against the, you know, $49 cell phone special, or I want to compete against what, then I think you're getting way more than you're paying for in every circumstance. So, true story. I wanted a wrist-mounted metronome. I have a Tama rhythm watch that I really, really like, it's not portable enough. So I wanted a small wrist-mounted metronome, and I found a company that makes one. And it was way too expensive, at least for my blood, so I wasn't going to buy it. But I found it on eBay, used, and I thought, well, I'll take a chance on that. So I purchased this used wristwatch metronome, and it arrives, and I take it out of the box, and in my mind, there should be three buttons on it. One to turn it on and off, one to turn the tempo up, and one to turn the tempo down. I say that, and I set my expectations there because that's how every metronome I've ever used in my life has worked. This one, I pull out, and it says, pair to the app. App? Why would I need an app? So I go download the app. The app wants my location data. No, I'm not giving you my location data. Okay, well, then you can't use the app. Why do you need to know where I am to set a thing to beep at a consistent interval? I mean, why? So I just threw the whole thing in the box. I just didn't use it. And I'm just like, this is stupid. I'm not doing this. I'm just not doing this. So my son orders a Pine Time and pulls it out of the box and goes, well, Dad, that comes built into the Pine Time. Check this out. And sure enough, there is exactly what I was looking for, a wrist-mounted metronome. And you open it up, and there's a play button to start and stop it, and there's even a little drag or dial doohickey thingamajig that you move back and forth to raise the tempo or lower the tempo. It works perfectly. You can even set the accent beats. Say, I want it to beat on one every four beats, every one beat, whatever. It's brilliant. So I thought to myself, self, $35, that's a small price to pay for exactly what you're looking for. And by the way, that's a fraction of what the stupid little proprietary metronome thing that I didn't end up using because it sucked. So I order one for myself. And originally, that's literally all I was going to do with it. I was going to set the time and I was going to use it for a metronome. But it gets here and my son is really into it. Dad, let me show you how to use it. And he had originally started with Siglo and then moved to a different application for using companion software called Watchmate. And he was telling me, well, I use ITD to get the notifications, but I've been using Watchmate to push the firmware, and this is really better than Siglo. And I'm like, okay, in the name of bonding, go ahead and show me all these cool things. So he sets it up on my laptop, and we get it paired and all of the things. Well, then I learned, Steve, I had this issue where I would take a laptop and I'd put it next to my nightstand, and I would use my laptop to keep an eye on, you know, if there's emergencies or somebody needs something, it would come through the laptop. Well, you know what happens then? It starts with, I just need to keep an eye on the emergencies. But then it kind of devolves into 4 a.m. I'm researching nuclear physics. And I'm like, how did I get here? And like one thing led to another. What can I say? The watch, you pair it with Watchmate. Again, completely open source firmware, open source Infinitime, open source Watchmate running on my open source Linux desktop. And I set the watch down on the nightstand. And for lack of a better way to describe this, it just like farts when like it goes off and it vibrates against the nightstand. And it was just like this little, and I'm like, oh, cool. There's a notification and I can go look through the last 5 messages. So I've gotten into the habit now as I fall asleep at night, I just set the watch down there. It pairs to my laptop that's on the dock. If there's something that comes up, I hear it. I wake up, I look at it, I read it. First thing I do when I wake up in the morning, flip through the notifications, see if there's anything important that came in. It's working great. In fact, the only even remotely negative thing I have to say about it is that Watchmate interprets me adjusting the brightness as notifications. So if I go up and change the brightness a tremendous amount, then I'll come back to the watch and it'll say brightness level up. But other than that, it's fantastic. That's the best $35 I've ever spent. And so since then, I walk around and I ask people, how much do you think that costs? Well, the Apple Watch is, you know, $1,000. I'm thinking you spent $500, $400. Yeah, $35. $35, a tenth of what you're guessing. It's just absolutely fantastic. So draw your attention to pine64.org. Look at their March update. Lots of cool things. A virtual assistant, bone conduction headphones. The Pine Tab finally has Wi-Fi, kind of, sort of. They have the driver improved, and it's kind of working, but there are some exceptions. Go to the blog. You can read more to learn more about the Pine Tab and Pine Tab and where they're at with their Wi-Fi driver. It's there if you're willing to use it. The notable exception is if you shut the thing down with the driver enabled, the driver hangs, and then it's a problem. So you have to make sure to manually unload the driver and then power the device down. Don't try to shut it off with the driver loaded or it's potentially problematic. But again, I still maintain anybody who bought a Pine Tab when they bought a Pine Tab did so because they wanted to participate in what Pine 64 was doing. And I had a very specific use case for the Pine Tab. That is to say, I wanted to display drum charts. We're slowly making progress. I wouldn't say I've gotten there yet. In part, I do need Wi-Fi for that to work, at least to work reliably or well. So we'll see. But I have broken out my Pine Book Pro has become my bedside. Just, I need a laptop, grab it. It floats around the house. That's been reloaded with Endless OS. They're just really fantastic hardware. And I think you consistently get more than what you pay for. So if you pay $200, you get a $500 worth of computer. You buy a $35 smartwatch, you're getting a $200 smartwatch. You buy a $150 phone or $175 phone, you're getting a $500 phone. I just think they consistently deliver more than what you're paying for. And they eat their own dog food. That is to say, their last blog post, they go into how they are running their entire website and their entire organization off their SBCs. And I think that's amazing. Pine64.com to buy the stuff. Pine64.org to learn about the organization. Music in ears means we're out of time. We're back next Tuesday, 6 p.m. Central. AskNoahShow.com.